Lord Jesus, I thank you that we can come here this morning to worship you and to praise your name. Lord, I thank you for the technology that we use, even if from time to time we get a bit frustrated with it and find we still have more to learn. And Lord, I just thank you for the wonderful opportunity that here on this meeting this morning, we've got people in Spain, we've got people in Cornwall, we've got people in Yelvertoft, we've got people listening live in a car between York and Nottingham. And Lord, we don't know, there might be other people as well, and that together we're together in you. And we pray now that we'll be able to stop focusing on the tools and just focus on you. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So I'm going to unmute Barry. And then...
Do I okay?
Well, that's really weird, Barry. I could still unmute you. I don't understand why I can unmute some people, but other people I can only ask to unmute. But...
As long as you don't ask me to explain the answer to your question, that's all right. So it's a joy to be able to share in these online services from Yelvertoft. I still feel a sense of it being home for me. So it's very special, and I'm grateful for the opportunity of being able to choose a hymn today. And I've chosen a well-known hymn sung in all sorts of churches. May the mind of Christ, my Saviour, live in me from day to day. And the story behind this is it's written by a lady called Kate Barclay Wilkinson. And I don't know that there are any other hymns in any hymn books written by this lady, and very little is known about her. She was born in Timperley, and she married a London man, an engineer, and she was an Anglican lady. She did a lot of work with young girls, so ministry to children was quite important, and she also had links with the Keswick Bible Convention. And she wrote this hymn somewhere, I should think, about in the middle to late 19th century. She died early in the 20th century, but it didn't get into any hymn books until later. It eventually, in 1975, got into the Keswick hymn book, and yet she'd been involved in Keswick all her life. And it was a long time before it got into ancient and modern, and yet she was an Anglican. But it's a hymn that's precious. And just to say, you could take each verse one at a time each day. So take a verse a day from this hymn. If you can find it in a book, take a verse a day and use it for meditation. Splendid hymn, wonderful sentiments. Exactly, I say amen to everything that Kate has written in this wonderful hymn.
Thank you, Barry. So just back to the sort of default slide. Excuse me a second. I've managed to dig up a presentation from April the 26th, not July the 26th. So give me a moment or two. Talk amongst yourselves.
The only place it would go perfectly right is in heaven.
Yes,
no worries. I normally get this fairly right at this point, but it's good and humbling to not do from time to time.
I'm going to make sure I mute myself now.
That would be appreciated. So, no, it still hasn't appeared on here. Okay.
Is it the 26th today?
It is. So we're going to have to share screen from here then.
It worked from here. What about the sound?
Go back to there.
Share sound, computer sound.
Yeah. So that should be fine. You've got the sound coming out of here, yep.
Yeah.
Haven't we, yeah? Right. So, that's on there. Yeah, keep going then.
Shall I go?
Yeah. Can you hear me now? No. We're muted. Stop the share a minute. We'll have to go back to where we were. No. They should be able to hear me.
We can hear you, yeah.
Okay, nobody answered. Okay. So, so we've got a special event to commemorate today because one of our number is 70. Yep, this weekend, sitting on his narrow boat. Bob, how does it feel? Do you want to unmute a second? Let me just ask you to unmute, and yeah, I've done. How does it feel to be 70, Bob?
A bit like yesterday. Having a wonderful weekend, everybody. Went to my daughter's yesterday for just a glass of wine and some nibbles. And it turned out all the family joined in on a Zoom meeting from all over the world, actually, because they're all in different places. And I must admit, it reduced me to tears. It was lovely. And we had some friends around last night for a couple of glasses of wine and a good laugh. And I'm enjoying myself, and thank God for it.
Okay, thank you, Bob.
I'm reading from Acts chapter 5. Ananias and Sapphira, now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property with his wife's full knowledge. He kept back part of the money for himself, but bought the rest and put it in apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? It belonged to you before it was sold, And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard what had happened. Then some young men came forward, wrapped up his body and carried him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife came in. Not knowing what had happened, Peter asked her, "Tell me, is this the price you and Ananias got for the land?" "Yes," she said, "that is the price." Peter said to her, "How could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? Listen, the feet of the men who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also." At that moment, she fell down at his feet and died. Then the young men came in, and finding her dead, carried her out and buried her beside her husband. Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events.
Thank you very much, Pam, for that. Thank you.
Do I alter you?
Just go forward to the end. So we come to our message from the passage, which was the next natural passage to read in the book of Acts. And if we think about the last section that we were reading a few weeks ago from the book of Acts, it was talking about the fact that the believers were together and they had everything in common, that they sold property and things to make sure that nobody had any needs. And in that situation, they were let's just de-spotlight Bob a second, just for the sake of... right, just give me a second while I find Bob and de-spotlight him, and then I'll... I must remember that when I've spotted people, spotlighted somebody, to cancel them afterwards. So hopefully that should do the trick, and the focus should move back to me. That's right. Okay, so so the people were selling things and bringing precious things and laying the results of that at the apostles' feet so that there was enough for the community of believers. And so in that situation, this was love spilling over. This was just an expression of God's love, what people are doing. We have this incredible story about Ananias and Sapphira. So can we go to the next slide, please, Jan? So it says there was a man named Ananias, together with his wife, Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. And with his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. There was nothing forcing them to sell property. People were selling things because their hearts were overflowing with love for God and love for one another. And in the midst of this, what becomes clear from the whole story is that Ananias and Sapphira decided to sell some property and go and put some money at the apostles' feet in a way that everybody would see it, but they kept some of it from themselves. And the problem wasn't that they kept some of it for themselves, as we see in the story as it spills out. It was the fact that there was a deception in what they were doing. And they were doing something to create an impression with the people around and to have the view that everyone would look at them and say, oh, they've sold a piece of property and bought it, when actually they'd only bought a part of the proceeds. And the result of this is quite a scary a story of what happens when, or can happen when, God is moving really powerfully. But it's important to think that this was a plan. I mean, I don't know how long it took to sell property in Jerusalem at that time. If that was the UK and you said in one sentence, he sold a house, yeah, then at the present time, then you can see that this is a plan that's hatched out over over months. Yeah, now maybe the process wasn't quite as long-winded at Jerusalem. We're not told how long this went on for. But it was certainly long enough that they were able to talk about it, plan it, and decide this is what they were going to do. And so their actions were deceitful. And as it happens, Peter then, when the money's brought to him, so Ananias is there bringing the property and putting it at the apostles' feet, expecting that it's going to be this kind of appreciation and gratitude. And imagine that in this situation, Peter says to him, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? And didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You've not lied just to human beings, but to God. And this incredible way in which what he'd done was a deception, because the Holy Spirit was causing people to give, and he was pretending that he'd given everything, and he hadn't really. Now, a few more weeks ago, we were talking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And Peter moved here in the gift of the word of knowledge. The theology of the word of knowledge hadn't yet been formalized. It was Paul who gathered the things that the Holy Spirit had been doing and formalized it into a theology to explain things. And that's why reading the epistles of Paul is so helpful in us having a systematic understanding. Paul was clearly a systematic theologian in the way that he wrote things down. So things hadn't been formalized in this way, but Peter here moves in the gift of the word of knowledge that we talked about when we were talking about the gifts of the Spirit. He had no natural means to know what had happened with Ananias, but God showed him there and then what was happening. And he showed him that here was Ananias trying to deceive not only the believers, but deceiving God. And it's really, really important in our attitudes to life that everything we do is open and honest. I remember, I know Bob's told me in his past about a situation in which he really felt that people close to him dressed up and looked the perfect people in church on Sunday, and what went on the rest of the week was something different. Yeah, and how often can a church be a place where people think, how am I going to make myself look sufficiently righteous to go into the church, and how am I going to maintain my reputation, you know? And when I have children who argue with me, how does that make me look in front of the other believers? I know I've had these sorts of experiences growing up, and a feeling of a pressure to be a perfect parent, perfect in every way, because how did you look before church? And before you know where you are, you've got the reality of what's going on in your life, and you've got what you're actually trying to show. Now, that can happen very easily to lots of us, but it's when it becomes a plan and a scheme that it becomes really serious. We can find ourselves inadvertently in that situation. But here, Peter confronts Ananias with the seriousness of what he was doing. And if we move on to the next slide. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard what had happened. And sometimes, you know, we talk about the Holy Spirit, and sometimes we just talk about the Spirit, and we miss off the Holy Spirit, and we do it for ease of language, because it's quicker to say the Spirit than the Holy Spirit. And it doesn't matter that we sometimes do that as shorthand, as long as we don't forget that the Holy Spirit is a Holy Spirit. And that when the Holy Spirit is moving in power, as he was at this point in the history of the church, on the one hand, they were seeing people healed and signs and wonders. They were seeing so much of the manifestation of God's power of heaven on earth, that in that environment where the Holy Spirit is moving so powerfully, he also demanded a holiness, and that there was no deceit. And when we pray for the Holy Spirit to move, we have to remember sometimes it's quite a dangerous thing to pray for. If we look at this story of Ananias and Sapphira, remember that when we're really asking for the Holy Spirit to move powerfully among us, we're asking that he refines us and cleans us. And I don't know of any other examples of what happened to Ananias and Sapphira, but we can expect that if we resist his purification, that life's going to get hard if the Holy Spirit is moving powerfully. If we're in a place where everybody's just getting on with their life and talking about Christian things but living life as normal, we can all sort of do that and things seem to go okay. But when we ask that God really moves in power, then he won't, things will get cleansed and sorted, and sin will come out into the open. And that's what you tend to see happens. It doesn't usually result in people dropping dead in the front of a meeting, but it does result in sin coming out into the open and being revealed when God moves powerfully in a fellowship. And, you know, over history, people have tried to do the work of the Holy Spirit by destroying heretics. Peter didn't actually do anything. He didn't lift a hand to Ananias and Sapphira. He identified what the Holy Spirit had shown him and confronted them with it. And at that point, actually, Ananias would have had the chance to repent and to acknowledge. I mean, we don't get, but he had the chance to repent, and we see it explicitly with Sapphira, that she had an opportunity when we get on to the next piece. She had an opportunity. He would have had an opportunity to say, wow, he didn't. And here we see the situation that people have tried to do the work of the Holy Spirit by destroying heretics. And it's very sad if you look in church history of the periods, especially around the Reformation, when people on both the Protestant and the Catholic side were responsible for the most horrific treatment of one another, with a sense that they were on a holy mission to destroy the heresy of the other one's beliefs. And I always find it strange and difficult to understand, but also an incredible warning to us that people in a real passion of having a sense of revelation of some things that they know are right can be quite blind to other things. But it's never our job to destroy other people because of their beliefs. If God chooses to do things, that's in his hands, but it's never our job to try and wipe people out because of their beliefs. And we can't make the church pure by eliminating the people who we disagree with. We can only make the church pure by, first of all, allowing the Holy Spirit to work on us and to cleanse our attitudes and our whole situation of love for one another, and to ask the Holy Spirit and to pray for the Holy Spirit to do a purifying work as a whole. Yeah, but you know, church history is littered with human mistakes, and church continues to be made up of people who make mistakes, and we can look at the mistakes of people hundreds of years before. I often say it's very easy to identify the sins of previous generations and be blind to the sins of our own generation. It's always incredible when you talk to some older people how they look at the younger people and think the younger people do much worse things than they do. Yeah, because they're aware of the things that younger people do wrong and not aware of the things that they themselves do wrong. And you can see that through history, that it's always been the case. And it's really dangerous to have that attitude, that we look at other people and think, aren't they terrible? What we have to ask is that the Holy Spirit asks us to show us the sin in our own life. But it's never our job to wipe other people out because of their sinfulness. Let's move on to the next slide. And then in this incredible story, about 3 hours after Ananias has dropped dead, his wife Sapphira came in not knowing what had happened. And Peter asked her, "Tell me, is this the price you and Ananias got for the land?" "Yes," she said, "that is the price." And Peter said to her, "How could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? The feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also." So Sapphira is given the chance in the question to be honest and to say what had happened. And she didn't take it. And she repeated her husband's lie, that they'd agreed together to lie to the fellowship. What a serious situation. What an incredible outcome, the end of two people's lives. But you know, there's an application for us in the life of church. When do we stop, and when we're making decisions about what we should do and shouldn't do, do we stop and think, oh, well, what will people think? What will the impression be? Yeah? Or do we think, what's the right thing for us to do? Yeah? And we can easily, especially in today's world when things are out there, we can easily make our decisions in our own personal life and in decisions and things that we might be discussing in church meetings about what will public opinion be of this, how will it look, and maybe we can try and make something that is a mess look good to try and cover up things that are wrong and make them look right on the outside. You know, I believe that in God's kingdom it's always right to face things as they are and to do the right thing, and if something is wrong, own up straight away that it's wrong, and the sooner you own up the better. And if you've left it too late, now is still better than later. there's never a time when it's too late to own up. It's always, if there's a deception that's been left hidden, it's always the right time to bring it out into the open in our church life. We're not to be in the place of keeping things hidden. Because when we deceive one another out of trying to create a good impression, before we know where we are, we find ourselves trying to deceive God. And before we know where we are, we believe that we're working awfully hard to do the right thing. And we've started doing things because we think people will see something that's good. And you know, that becomes our practice, because it's very easy that the things we do become our routine and our practice. So we need to really be people who try as far as possible, seek as far as possible, to be open in our dealings with one another. Now, I'm not saying that we should all come to church and immediately pour out our hearts about every issue that's going on in our lives to everyone, because that can lead to a lot of hurt and pain, because not everybody is in a place to receive that. But it's important for all of us that we find people that we trust and that we come to know, and that when we're struggling with something, we can talk to them about it. And it's important that if something isn't lined up in our lives, that we set about to deal with it. And if something isn't lined up, I speak especially to myself, if we know that we've got things going on in our lives that are really serious things that we're battling with, we have to stop and ask, should I be leading a service on Sunday? Should I be preaching on Sunday? From a point of view that I'm effectively deceiving other people, that if people only knew what was going on in my life, then they'd see me as a hypocrite. And that I'm saying telling other people how they should live, and yet hiding from them my own life and the way that I live. And it's a challenge, because there can be things that are not suitable for sharing, and that it's not the right time to tell people about them. And we need to be clear, if we're preaching and teaching, that we're not hypocritical. And there are always things that God is convicting us of. One of the things I love about the Christian journey is it's a journey. And that if God confronted us with all of our sin on the day we became a Christian, we'd just be there. It was impossible. How could we deal with it all? And he doesn't. He very graciously asks us to repent. And at the point that we repent, we make a decision to say, I'm going to try and follow your ways. And over time, God shows us things, and sometimes he shows us things immediately that need to change in our life. There are people who become a Christian and at that point in time suddenly are convicted about their language, and their language changes. I've heard people give that testimony. There are people who've become a Christian, and at the day they've become a Christian, they've stopped smoking. Yeah, and it's just happened. And there are other people who, it's years later when God confronts them with something and says, you need to deal with it. Yeah, and I don't know why it is that God does those things in that order, but what matters is that the Holy Spirit does deal with us in those ways, and he deals with us as individuals. And again, it's not our job to be the Holy Spirit in each other's lives. Yeah, and we can't get ourselves into a place where we're accusing people. I was brought up in a world where you could hardly imagine that a Christian would smoke. I mean, so if there was somebody in the church who smoked, you can be very sure that they wouldn't do it anywhere near anyone from the church. There probably were people, but the attitude of intolerance is something that would drive hypocrisy. Because people would feel so condemned if they were to show that they were a smoker in the face of other Christians. They would feel so condemned that they would make sure that they never ever let anybody know. And then they're in a much more difficult place, because now they've established an area of secret sin in their life, which is much more difficult to deal with than saying, this is a challenge I've got and I'm praying that God will give me the strength to deal with it and to leave it behind, and for that to be something that's open and people can pray with them about. And so, although this story is really quite unique in terms of us hearing about an incident where sin is shown and somebody just drops down dead, we don't have lives that are full of that. The principle behind it that shows how God hates deception and hypocrisy. And you think, Jesus showed us that. Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And what did Jesus speak against all the time when he was on earth? He spoke about hypocrisy. He spoke about the Pharisees creating burdens for other people that they had to live with while ignoring the sin in their own life. And, it's really important that we as church deal in reality. And that when we ask the Holy Spirit to come and move, then we're not just asking him. He doesn't come and say, well, I'll bring you this bit, I'll bring you miracles and healings and all that bit, but actually we'll leave alone the purification and the holy aspects of the Spirit. When we ask for the Holy Spirit to move powerfully, we're going to expect that he's going to come, and if he does things that are amazing, he's going to convict us of sin, and he's going to leave us at times when we're weeping at things. Not because we're weeping because we're going to feel disgusting from now on. Weeping because we're being set free and shown things that he's sorting out in our lives so that we can be more and more like him. And the Holy Spirit comes with works of power that include the very holiness that's in his name. Purification of his people. And we need to want both. We need to want a Holy Spirit who's going to make us more right with God. And as he makes us more right with God, more able to be used in God's purposes. Shall we pray? Lord, we thank you that you are indeed a Holy Spirit. You are indeed a holy God, and the Holy Spirit a Holy Spirit. And Lord, we thank you for this demonstration of your holiness in this story in the book of Acts. And Lord, we pray that you would make each of us open to your purifying work, to cleansing our hearts and minds, that we might become conformed more and more to your likeness. And Lord, we pray especially that if there's areas where we live in deception, and we live an image on the outside that's vastly different from the things on the inside, that you'll help us close that gap. Help us talk to somebody and be honest. Seek out somebody who'll pray with us about it. Get with you and really ask for you to help us close that gap. Because, Lord, we don't want to be hypocrites. We want to be people of integrity. People whose lives reflect your holiness. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just do it.
Yeah.
Lift up his name in all the earth.
praise and give him glory, for he is worthy to be praised. Lift up his name with the sound of singing. Lift up his name in all the earth. Lift up your voice and give him glory, for he is worthy to be praised. For he is worthy to be praised.
Now we come to our time of prayer. Let's just start with a moment of acknowledging before the Lord that we all fall short of his glory. Lord, we do just acknowledge that we all fall short of your glory. Lord, we get a glimpse of your holiness and your righteousness, and we become conscious of how different we are from that. But Lord, we thank you for the work of your Holy Spirit that refines us and makes us want to be more like you. Lord, we thank you for your blood that cleanses us and washes us clean. So Lord, we pray that you would keep us as humble people, aware of our failings, but confident in your love and power to be able to walk with you in spite of our own weaknesses, Lord. Apostle Paul says, when I'm weak, I am strong. And that sense that when we know our weaknesses, then we depend on you to carry us through. So keep us, Lord, depending on you, relying on you to be our strength. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So now let's just spend a moment. A few weeks ago, Ken challenged us to think of three people to pray for. So let's spend a moment thinking of whoever it is that we named and lifting them before us. If we haven't got them, then just stop and think who you want to pray for this morning. And at the end of a week where we've been close to three funerals from the village, Barry took Dave McCartney's funeral on Thursday, and I took the funeral of Richard Morris on Monday, and of George Dool, whose wife is Susan Vincent, on Friday. And all of those families, now the other side of the funeral and the practicalities and facing life ahead. So we pray for them, Lord. We pray for each one, for the different way in which they're missing their loved ones. And we pray for Nimish's family, both here and in India, after the death of her grandma as well, Lord. We pray that your strength and your peace would be with them. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And Lord, we pray for people being treated for cancer. For Lynn Poog, who's after so many months and years, Lord, of treatment. And we thank you for keeping her with us all this time. We pray for continued success of her treatment. We pray for Margie, Lord. Pray for David, Nicholas, and for Nina Mills, Lord. Pray that you would be with each one of them at this point. Thank you, Lord. And then we pray for others who are sick. We pray for Anne, for Megan, for Lee Hay, and for Sheila Powell, who was not with us this morning and wasn't with us last week because she's struggling with adjustments to her drugs that have been made, but is in good spirits, but just finding life difficult at the moment. So, Lord, we lift all of them before you in Jesus' name. Amen. And Lord, we want to pray as some of us meet to discuss plans for the months ahead. We want to pray that you would prepare us, Lord, and help us to do the right things for the extension of your kingdom, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. And so we've got our next song, Before the Throne of God Above, that we had last week as well. But just good to know that, and remind ourselves when we talked about a holy God, that before the throne of God above we have a strong and perfect plea. We don't need to be afraid because we have Jesus who has given everything for us, and all we need to be is honest with God. And when we're honest with God and come before him as we are and lay our hearts before him, then Jesus has done everything to guarantee our forgiveness and to make us have a position of righteousness before God. Thank you.
How do I mute everyone?
They're not unmuted.